Snow College, got in touch with me and he said, you know, there's something going on at college that has to do with some interesting alternative and renewable energy, specifically in biofuels. And when I got a call, I was talking about my boss, he said, when I got a call about it, he said, I have a man that I think should go into your meeting. This is just a meeting of some of these individuals that are assembling up here right now. So a few months ago, I find myself up at the Ephraim campus of Snow College, and I'm seated elbow to elbow with Scott Wyatt, our new president, while these people, David Drake and his team, these were only some of them, by the way. Is there anybody else here with you guys today? No? Kind of outlined what they've been doing. And what I realized that they've been working on what they're about to present to you for the past 3 years, I thought, my gosh, I wonder why it is that, you know, that no one has heard about these things. Because, you know, it was just something that was astounding. And in the next 60 minutes of that meeting, I learned about not only what they had been doing, but its implications and potential for global installation. And I'm going to let you learn from them rather than have me thrown on. But I'd like to introduce their team leaders, a fellow named David Drake, who I've seen here in Richfield for quite a while. He's officed in our county building. After completing his doctoral work at Purdue, David worked for the Utah State University Extension in Richfield since 2002, and he's currently conducting research and outreach on biofuel production. Now, how he's gone about that with these good guys and what they've done is going to be, I believe, very, very, very interesting, which is one of the reasons why we say that to the end. Dr. Drake is a principal investigator in the Central Utah Biodiesel Project, a grassroots organization that includes USU Extension, Snow College, farmers, and innovators. And there's contact information for David if you want to learn more about this. When I heard about what they've been doing, the trials they had gone through in terms of the specific ingredients, if you will, of their research, and then how that could apply, I'm going to tell you, you know, it's making pioneers in our midst, and they haven't really received much of the publicity or acknowledgement that they're due. I would also like to suggest, before they take the time and then also we wrap the day, that you people here are pioneers as well. What's going on in this very room today may have some application in your life. I'm going to guarantee you that it will have serious application in your lives 3 years from now. And so I'd like to acknowledge all of you and have you consider yourselves pioneers right here in Central Utah, the real Central Utah, not that Provo, Orem place that calls itself Central Utah. Without droning on any further, let me just introduce David Drake and his team, Doug Wendell and Al Tripp. A warm welcome to them. And of course, all pioneers, you want to get one of my pioneer t-shirts at the end of the day, right?
Today, I just want to give you an overview of the natural resources and agricultural resources we have in the state of Utah in the biofuels arena. So I'll tell you about that, tell you about evaluating some options, talk about our resource advantages and opportunities. We'll tell you about the Central Utah Biodiesel Project, and then talk about some of the synergistic opportunities. There's more than biodiesel that comes out of this project.
When he said more than biodiesel comes out of this project, that's a foreshadowing of the real.
I'm trying to keep you awake. Okay, obviously, energy is a hot topic, otherwise we wouldn't be in this room. And we have things such as the Coalition for 20% Renewable Energy by the year 2020. Myself working in agriculture, we have an Energy Future Coalition that came up and said we'd like 25% of that energy to be agriculturally derived by the year 2025. And not to downplay biodiesel, but the majority of that is wind and solar. That's the goal for now. Next slide. All right. If we look at fossil fuel alternatives, I've listed some we've talked about today. I just want to say, first of all, the biggest bang for our buck is conservation. And so I encourage you all to look into ways of conservation as we explore other opportunities of generating other alternatives. Next slide. As you evaluate these energy opportunities, I like to think about inputs and outputs. And so, you know, what's the net energy going in? What's the net energy coming out? There's a lot of hype and misinformation and information out there about that. Particularly in our state, we need to think about water, because if we're doing something, we're using water, and water's precious. We need to look at our land. We need to look at the capital investment. What's the cost of this alternative energy? We need to look at the technology available. What's the cost of it? And then we have the carbon issue to think about. Is it an advantage or disadvantage? Next, please. And then also along those, you know, there are pros and cons. What's the cost? What's the ease of substitution, for example? And then I'm going to tell you biodiesel is great because you just put it right in the tank. As opposed to something else, you may need to modify your vehicle or get an entirely new vehicle. What's the net energy output in British thermal units? What government programs are available? And what is economical versus profitable? I have a lot of people show up in my office frequently, and they know something about biodiesel, and they're out to make $1 million. Share a little bit with me, but some of these processes, they may be economical, they will help, but they may not make you $1 million. Okay. As I look at Utah's resources, what do we have in the area of biofuels? We have forests, we have rangelands, we have croplands, all of our farmlands. Also on the farms, we have manures and other wastes that can be used to make biofuels. And even we have municipal and industrial waste. The sewer treatment plants, those are all sources and resources to us in Utah that we can look for energy. Okay, specifically I'm going to talk about today ethanol. And I'll say ethanol, you've heard a lot about it. Most people have heard, you know, we use corn to make ethanol, and basically you're fermenting the sugars and the starches in the corn to make the ethanol. And then it's distilled. But there's another way of making ethanol that's on the horizon. I won't talk about it a lot, but it would impact Utah greatly, and that is if you can make cellulosic ethanol. And so instead of taking the sugar and fermenting it, you're going to take the cellulose or the wood or the cardboard in that plant, ferment that. And that would actually yield a greater amount of ethanol per unit. So for example, you know, a bushel of corn yields approximately 2.8 gallons of ethanol, a bushel being 52 pounds. That equivalent in cellulosic would be several times greater. So that's the interest. Now that nut hasn't been cracked yet. There's a lot of people working on it. But that technology isn't here today. That's a little bit for tomorrow. Methanol, another form of alcohol. And if you have questions on that, that's why Doug's here. He's the chemist. Methane, which is the gas that comes off of manure, comes off of landfills, comes off of waste treatment plants, that can be used, burned directly, or even turned into methanol. Then we have synthetic gases where you can take plant material or use plant material in the case of manure, put it through a process, and that will generate gases. For example, the military is very interested in this because right now, you know, the Air Force uses jet fuel, and the Army uses diesels, and they would like to be able to have one fuel that goes all the way through the military. So that may be a future, and then we'll talk about biodiesel. Next slide, please. Just some pictures of Utah's resources. This is a tractor or equipment they use to harvest trees in Europe. And you know, basically, we have tremendous forest resources. and we have some that need to be harvested, and we have some that are pinyon juniper. We have tremendous areas that there's a resource there. Part of the trouble is getting to it, and that may be solved by machines. Next slide. Okay. That talks about, you know, the forest things talks about our public lands, our rangelands. On all of our farmlands, I put a slide about alfalfa hay up here, we're already in the business of harvesting biomass. And we harvest 5 tons of alfalfa per acre a year on most of our alfalfa fields. That's several thousand acres. Next slide. Here's an example of another biomass we're into harvesting. This is barley, wheat, triticale, oats. There's another 5 tons of biomass. Next slide. Here's another slide of corn, sorghum. As much as 10 tons per acre of this biomass. Next slide. So those are the potentials for cellulosic ethanol, but like I said, it's not there yet. Now, when I got involved in the biodiesel project, you know, basically working in the extension office, we are the public education arm of Utah State University. We're bringing the university, the knowledge of the university to you. In my program, Univ Agriculture, that's what I work with. But I have people come in and they say, I need an answer for this question, or I've got this great idea, and they bring it to me first and help me evaluate. You know, I help them evaluate it. So in the biodiesel project, about 2005, the people here to my left came and started talking to me. And basically, this project was started because of farmers and citizens. The Snow College Chemistry was involved. I had these two county economic development committees come to me and say, we're interested in this as an additional economic output for our county. And then I had other USU Extension colleagues receiving the same questions. That's how the biodiesel project got started. Next slide. Okay, why do I like biodiesel as opposed to some of the other technologies? Well, it's easily substitutable. I told you a minute ago, you can just put it in your tank and go. You don't have to have an E85 vehicle or the other modifications. Diesel is a farm fuel. It's the primary farm fuel. Processing can be small scale. I'll show you in a minute. You can make diesel fuel in a pop bottle, or you can make it in a several hundred gallon or thousand gallon tank, but it's scalable. If you want to build an ethanol plant in Utah, the optimum size for an ethanol plant is 100 million gallons a year, and that will cost you the equivalent in millions of dollars. But if you know, if you saw our trailer as you walked in, that's a $6,000 plant. That's easily scalable, and as we talked about this morning when Tim gave you introductions, you know, we're looking at community, we're looking at small scale, we're looking at self-sufficiency. Biodiesel fits that bill. Biodiesel also uses less water than ethanol. Excluding the water to grow the crop, ethanol uses 4 gallons of water to every 1 gallon of ethanol. Biodiesel is a 1-to-1 ratio. And remember on the slide it says, think about water. Other thing is, you need to take the product from the farm to the plant, and if you have a big bale of hay, you know, it's a large bulky item, it's harder to take there than energy seeds. Energy seeds or oil seeds have oil in them. Oil is energy dense, and so it's more easily transported. That's why I like biodiesel. Next slide. Just to give you a brief overview, basically you take the fatty acids in vegetable oils, and they resemble an octopus with the glycerin as the head holding the legs together. In the biodiesel process, you add alcohol and a lye that cuts off the head of the octopus and leaves the legs. And I think Dallas Hanks, if he's still here for that analogy. Basically, you turn the top into biodiesel, the glycerin comes out the bottom. You need to wash it with water, you separate it and dry it, and then you've got biodiesel. Now, the notation, and you're familiar with E85 with ethanol, well, biodiesel you use B, so B100 is 100% biodiesel, B20 is 20% biodiesel. Next slide. Okay, now I have a series of pictures on how to make biodiesel. In the interest of time, I can skip that, or we can go ahead and do it. Do you have any preferences?
Skip through them?
Okay.
No, no, no. We want to see them all, yeah. Because there's a mystery behind this that's unfolding. You may not recognize it yet, but there is, and the denouement is about to occur.
Okay. These pictures are all courtesy of Doug Wendell. So we have in the pop bottle, when you actually go online and find the Dr. Pepper biodiesel method, if they use a Dr. Pepper bottle, but put your vegetable oil in the bottle. Next slide, please. Okay, then you would, in this case, taking it out of the bottle and it's in a flask, but you want to get your vegetable oils, heat it to 125 degrees, add your methanol and lye. Next slide. And then it separates. And if you look in that flask, the top is biodiesel and the bottom is glycerin. Now this flask, in the tanks you saw outside, they're cone-shaped, so it's easily separatable. Next slide. Okay, so drain off the glycerin off the bottom. Now glycerin is a byproduct that, if it's purified, glycerin has a lot of uses. If you look at your cosmetics or other human uses, that it's a product that's, it can be sold for money. It can be used as a compost. It can be put in animal feeds. Or it can even, in this form, it can even be put down the drain. Andy, you had a question?
I do. I'm wondering about the different types of lye. Aren't there two different types that you can use? And the glycerin from either one of those can be used for different products, such as a fertilizer, go back in your field, couldn't it? Or
so you have sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide. And do you have any comments, Doug?
Sodium hydroxide is the cheapest.
Turn on.
Sodium hydroxide is the cheapest, of course, and potassium hydroxide, it really shouldn't any of it end up in the glycerol anyway, and so it wouldn't matter that much to what you use the glycerol for.
Can you use the glycerol for a fertilizer?
Yes.
Well, back to the biodiesel, we're draining off the glycerol from the bottom. Next slide. Okay. Then they're slowly adding water, I believe. This one, next slide. It sounds funny, you're going to add water to your fuel, and everyone knows that you don't want water in your fuel tank, but part of the reaction, you can generate soap. And so you want to wash it out, and wash the impurities out. And on this slide, she's slowly tipping that bottle. The bottom is the water, and the top is the biodiesel. Next slide. And then you do another separation where the biodiesel rises to the top. Lighter density, and drain off the water. Next slide. There we are, draining off the water. And then in this case, you can heat it to drive off the water, or you can let it evaporate. Next slide. And so this is the curve in the Snow College Chemistry Biodiesel class. These are all made by students in Snow College, so courtesy of Doug. All right, that was an overview of making biodiesel. I'll tell you what we've been using in Utah. Now, everywhere I come to do this presentation, I get a different idea. And so basically, I'm looking at oilseed crops. We're looking for vegetable oil. Now, almost all seeds have oil, but the content varies. It's been a lot of money on diesel fuel as a farmer. And that was the interest in this project. Is they use a lot of diesel fuel. The price goes up. Their bottom line already is pretty tight, and so if the price of fuel goes up, which they may have no control over, then what do they do? And so we wanted to give them options to produce their own if they'd like. And so what some of the options are growing these oilseed crops. I'll just give you some pictures of what these look like. This is camelina. It's called Golden Pleasure. It's been used by ancient societies in the old world. In the United States, we considered it a weed. In fact, when we first planted it, all my colleagues said, well, if it takes off as a weed, we're going to call it drink weed. And that would be infamous the rest of my life. Next slide. Okay, here's the seeds, very small seeds. It's a nice rice crop because it's low input, it grows in dry places. I'll show you pictures of that. And also, it's heart-healthy oil. It has high omega-3, so I'll let you to know about that. Here's canola. Hard to see. Next slide. Canola is little black seeds, and so next time you buy your canola oil, you know well, that comes from little black seeds. Next slide. Here's a picture of a lot of these crops together. On your left is canola in flower. Those are the yellow flowers. Then you have camelina. Then you have safflower, and then some more canola and camelina plots. Next slide. Here's safflower seed. If you're not familiar with it, it looks like sunflower seed. They are in different families, plant families. Safflower is actually a thistle. Any of you that grow thistles know that thistles grow well. And so safflower does grow well. They also have thorns. It's not a crop when it's mature you want to go running through. It's pretty prickly. And then, of course, you have sunflower. I will say that the sunflowers that we're growing for this are they're short hybrids. They're not the big tall ones. We want them about 3-4 feet tall so we can go through the combine. Next slide. Here's a picture of last year in Wayne County. We've got sunflower on the left. We've got safflower. We've got canola, camelina, and we've even got sorghum growing in this picture. Next slide. Here's a picture of a field day in Ephraim. And we've got camelina in the front. Safflower back in the back of the yellow flowers. And then surrounded by canola and then sunflowers on the far right. What is the yield of these crops in terms of farmers' yield? So camelina, in terms of gallons per acre, depending on how good a farmer you are and how much water you get, and all those factors, how many weeds grew in your field, you can get between 7 and 37 gallons per acre.
That's of the oil, not of the fuel.
This is the oil. Yep. And the question was already asked today, what's the equivalent? If I have 1 gallon of vegetable oil, how much biodiesel does it make? Well, it's 1 for 1. Okay? So, there's the crops. Canola, you can get up to 63 gallons per acre. Safflower, up to 143 gallons per acre. Sunflower, up to 171 gallons per acre. So, as I told people that, I said, great, can I grow safflowers in my backyard? And sure, you can. There's also the potential for fall canola to grow 150 gallons per acre. That's still under research. As I said, part of our project was to take this to the farmers so they could be self-sufficient. And this is another picture of the trailer outside. The project received a generous grant from the Utah Department of Agriculture for this biodiesel demonstration and processing trailer. On the trailer in the back, we have a blue oilseed press. It's basically just a screw press that forces the seeds through a small opening, squeezes the oil out, and then in the foreground we have the biodiesel reactor tanks where they actually make the biodiesel in 50-gallon batches. We use the same process that I described earlier, it's just in a larger scale. This complete trailer, the equipment inside, costs somewhere around $10,000. So it's something that a farmer, if he's using 1,000 gallons of diesel a year, it's something that fits in his, you know, he can invest in that. We got the trailer so that they could try it out and see if they want to buy the equipment for themselves. Next slide. I get a lot of questions, so what's the bottom line with biodiesel? This slide's a little bit old, but it'll give you an idea. Basically, if you're a farmer, you want to grow safflower, you can harvest that seed and you can go sell it to the birdseed people and get $375 per acre. That's your gross sale. Now, currently, alfalfa hay, in fact, this slide's a little bit old, but at that time you could get a gross income of $500 per acre. So, what I'm trying to show here is I don't see all the alfalfa hay being plowed under and planting a safflower in there. You can still make more money growing it. Okay. Part of it, and then let's say you grow the safflower and you make your own biodiesel. Well, you have a byproduct, and that byproduct is the seed cake or the seed meal. Now the seed cake is valuable because you can feed it to animals. And actually it's being sold right now for about $300 a ton. So you have to add that into your mind. If you went and bought wholesale vegetable oil at this time, it was $2.50 a gallon. And then if you treat that, make it into biodiesel, the treatment cost is, this slide says $1.50. The processor we have outside says 75 cents, so somewhere between $0.75 and $1.50 a gallon for treatment. That puts biodiesel cost around $4 per gallon. Now, in 2005, when I showed you that, people weren't very interested. Okay, this summer, people were more interested. Right? Because diesel fuel was approaching $5 per gallon. And so there's the numbers. I just refer back to my slide where I talked about economical versus profitable. This may be economical for a farmer to do. It may not be profitable for him to sell to the neighbors. It may be economical for us in central Utah to be fuel self-sufficient. It may not be profitable for Wasatch Front to talk us into growing it for them. Next slide. How does this fit into farm sustainability? And so if we look at the basic Utah irrigated farm crop rotation, they grow 5 years of alfalfa, then they plant corn for 2 years, and then they plant barley another year before they go back to alfalfa. If you look at the diesel fuel use for each crop, alfalfa uses 18 gallons per year. Corn silage uses 12 gallons per year, and the year of barley uses 5 gallons per year.
Is that on 1 acre?
That's per acre per year.
Per acre per year.
Okay, so in that entire rotation, 7 year rotation, they would use on average 117 gallons of diesel fuel per acre. So if we were to take out the corn silage or the barley, which has a similar fuel use to any of these crops I just showed you, and substitute that, if we substitute it with one that yielded 117 gallons or more, then all of a sudden the farmer can be self-sufficient just by changing his rotation. So they can still grow their alfalfa hay, they can still grow corn silage or barley, and they've got all their fuel. Now obviously, if you're a farmer, you rotate your fields through, so you're not planting the whole farm to one thing every 1 year. All right, next slide. So we've demonstrated it's possible. If the farmers in this area decide to stop sending checks across the ocean, they can grow their own biodiesel and be just fine. Right? What about Utah as a whole? So if the farm industry in Utah decided we want to grow all of our own biodiesel, be self-sufficient, we've calculated that they would need 11 million gallons of biodiesel per year. Okay, and that's based on average, the farms in Utah use 11 gallons of diesel fuel per crop acre. Right now, as of the 2002 census, there were 961,000 harvested acres in Utah, and there were 15,000 farms, and so a farm on average uses 700 gallons per year of diesel fuel. Now, obviously, it varies because every farm varies. So, could Utah be self-sufficient? They could, and on the typical dryland wheat rotation is you plant wheat 1 year, leave the field fallow, and then plant the wheat the next year. USU research has shown that that yields, in this particular study, yields 364 bushels of wheat every other year. Now, if you take wheat 1 year and then plant safflower the next year, because of the safflower is a deep-rooted crop that can go down there with this taproot and get the nutrients and water out, then plant fallow the next year, you can get 300 bushels of wheat and an additional 4,000 pounds of safflower. So this is using the same land, the same crop. So you actually get pretty much close to the same wheat yield and you get the additional oil. So if we converted all the wheat acreages in Utah to that, we would yield 6 million gallons of safflower oil. Okay, this is a 6-year study. So this is 300 bushels per acre over 6 years. If we switch from a wheat fallow rotation to a wheat safflower we can get the safflower and pretty much maintain the wheat yield. We actually get some advantages because you can control the wheat weeds while you're growing safflower. Alright? Also, I talked about the seed mill. When we press these seeds out, we get 40% oil, but we get 60% meal. And so, you know, the 11 million gallons of vegetable oil would yield 69 tons of seed meal. In Utah, we currently have about 86,000 dairy cows. They could easily consume that meal. And that meal that they're consuming now is shipped in from the Midwest as soybean meal. So we can easily feed this product to our own cows, and then that saves us the $300 per ton.
David, let me make sure that everybody's grasping the concept of what is unfolding before your eyes here. What he's just describing, and correct me, you guys, all three of you, if I'm out of bounds. What he's describing is growing a crop that will furnish oil that can be converted to biodiesel. Okay. The byproduct of that crop, after the oil has been extracted and used to make diesel fuel for the farm, can be fed to the animals on the farm. And they raised that crop, fueled their implements with diesel, biodiesel, feed the byproduct to the poultry, and now all of a sudden this farm operation, whether it's in Kenya or Milford or wherever, is pretty much sustaining itself on a number of levels. Am I right about that?
Any community that values its farm base needs to assure that farm base. They can't assure it while banking on market energy. So they have to decouple themselves in some efficient way from market energy, which is dependent on Middle East politics, among other things. And so each community, whether it be in central Utah or in Kenya, has to come up with their own modalities. But biodiesel seems to be a product which is sufficiently versatile that it can be adapted economically to local conditions. And I think as this project has shown, every area, even one as primitive as central Utah,
Sanpete County,
yes, has people of all different interests who can band together and come up with something which is suggestive, if not at this point, completely definitive.
Okay. What do we do with that meal? Well, in Sanpete County, we've done feeding trials on turkeys. Next slide. And actually, if we grew camelina to make biodiesel, that would supply the turkey meal for the turkeys, which they currently ship in the soybean meal, and we would have a byproduct of 700,000 gallons of biodiesel. Maybe that's a better way to look at it. We're just feeding our turkeys and we have a biodiesel byproduct. Okay, as opposed to making biodiesel, we have a turkey feed byproduct. Those are what I'm calling synergistic opportunities. And I think it has to do with what's the biodiesel bottom line. Yeah, maybe it's $4 a gallon, but we have all these other considerations we need to think about. But the question is, in my opinion, could the synergies in this project help the turkey plant that's having troubles in the San Diego County? Yes, they could. They could, you know, they make their decisions, but they're producing turkey fat, they're buying product, and, you know, both of those inputs and outputs affect their bottom.
What you get by feeding camelina is a omega-3 enriched, heart healthy turkey. That's been proved by Matt Palmer and his colleagues in Ephraim.
Pretty fat, how?
Excuse me?
Are they pretty fat on camelina?
Oh, well, they're an acceptable market bird, sure. They taste great and they're heart healthy. They're a premium bird. Yeah.
I, I appreciate that. I admitted that my presentation forgot it actually. Yes, camelina meal is high omega 3, and so when you feed that to turkeys, research has shown you can double and sometimes triple the omega 3 levels in the turkey meat. And so now you have a heart healthy turkey, which you can sell to go with your smart balance spread, right?
Okay. I originally became interested in the project because I've spent 35 years as a research geophysicist. And among that time was a great deal of effort looking at discovering and producing oil wells. So unlike that very charming candidate, and I might agree with her in saying drill baby drill, but I certainly don't think that it is a panacea for our problems. In fact, I think that we are at peak oil or very close to it. I certainly know that 75-80% of the world's oil are controlled by government-controlled companies in countries that don't really like us and have a different view of rule of government than we, or rule of law than we do. And I, for one, think that we're at a point where every community has to be wondering what they're going to be doing when the price of diesel is not just $3 a barrel, or $3 a gallon, $4 a gallon, but when it is 10, 15, 20, or perhaps, since you're living in a small rural environment, is not available for weeks or months on end. And I think this project and the people who have dedicated a lot of time and effort show that, it can be done. We can at least get that out.
I'd just like to acknowledge the many, many people who helped me on this project. They come from all areas of the government, the industry. There's a lot. I won't go through them all. But there's a lot of people involved, and we're looking for partners all the time. So if you have any ideas, share them with us.
How about a big hand of thanks for these pioneers here.